Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Nuestro año es felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad.
Well, season's greetings, Spring Lake Village. I hope you enjoyed that rendition of Feliz Navidad by the three tenors. So it is now Friday, the 18th of December, and this will be the last lecture for 2020. As you know, Christmas will be landing on a Friday, and New Year's as well. So our next lecture won't be until Friday, the 8th of January. So this week, we're going to wrap up our three-part lecture series, which was devoted to Hanukkah and Christmas. Last week, we searched for the legendary Magi, or wise men from the East. And this week, our lecture will focus on a search for Saint Nicholas. So this week's lecture is entitled From Bishop to Gift Giver, Unraveling the Legend of Saint Nicholas. So Nicholas, whose name means victory of the laity, victory of the people, so victory of the Christian flock, was already one of the most venerated saints of the early church, especially during the Byzantine period. And much of what we know about him is pretty much shrouded in mystery. The early church wrote a number of treatises, works called hagiography, literally writings of saints, that a lot of times drew on earlier traditions, even pagan traditions, and many exploits about early Greco-Roman heroes were often conflated into stories, legends, revolved around some of the most venerated saints of the church, and that's true with Nicholas. Nevertheless, there are primary sources that strongly suggest that he was an actual historical figure. The most reliable primary source was not published until about some four centuries after the death of Nicholas by a monk, head of a monastic order by the name of Michael the Archimandrite. But he does draw on earlier source material, and it's Michael who provides the most reliable account of the man called Nicholas. He was supposedly born on the Ides of March, either in 270 or 260 AD, although there are some accounts that say he was even born about 10 years later. Most of the sources say he was born in the Lycian town of Patara, which was located in Asia Minor, now present-day Turkey. Here is a picture in the upper right-hand corner of the great colonnaded street of Patara, leading to the harbor. It was a prosperous port city during the height of the Roman Empire, and it's been quite well excavated, and it's a site that is still visited today and still excavated by archaeologists. According to Michael, Nicholas was born into a prosperous merchant family. His parents had already converted to the Christian faith. The traditional names of his parents were Epiphanios, which means to make manifest, and Johanna. Now, at the time that Nicholas was born, the Roman state was persecuting Christians. One of the earliest persecutions took place in the 3rd century under the reign of the emperor Decius. But about the time that Nicholas was born, the Roman emperor Aurelian unleashed a very, very murderous persecution against the Christian communities. And Nicholas was born during this very unsettling period for the various Christian communities that flourished in Asia Minor in cities like Patara. We're told by Michael that when Nicholas was young, his parents died as a result of a plague. There were a number of epidemics that resulted in the death of a number of people, especially in a number of the port cities. After the death of his parents, we're told that he made a pilgrimage to Egypt, as well as to Palestine. And after his return from the Holy Land and Egypt, he returned to Myra, where he was now living, and he became the bishop. It was an episcopacy. And according to some traditions, his uncle had been a bishop of Myra. And so he succeeded in the footsteps of his uncle, becoming the bishop of this important Byzantine community where Eastern Orthodoxy flourished. Now, the most violent of all the persecutions or pogroms against the Christian communities occurred during the reign of the Emperor Diocletian. This was the great persecution, and literally thousands of Christians were put to death during Diocletian's infamous reign. And it wouldn't be until the ascendancy of Constantine the Great that the persecution would come to an end. So during the Great Persecution, there is strong evidence that Nicholas had been tortured during his imprisonment, even beaten, and he may have suffered some kind of physical harm. Actual beatings that took place that affected him throughout his life. So we're also told that upon the death of his parents, he gave away most of his wealth to the needy and the downtrodden. And many of the accounts relating to him have to do with acts of benefaction, of giving away his money to the poor. And some of these exploits are preserved in Michael's life of St. Nicholas. The most famous of these accounts is the famous story of how he helped a man and his three daughters. The story is told that how in the city of Myra, a man by the name of Michael, who had at one time been a man of great means, lost his wealth. We know that he had converted to the Christian faith. Without that money, he could not pay the necessary dowries for his three daughters, who were now of married age. And at this time, it was not uncommon for daughters to be either sold into slavery or turned to prostitution. So Nicholas heard of the plight of this Christian man, and he decided he would help provide the dowry money for his three daughters. And so I'm sure you're familiar with the story of how Nicholas, by night, threw a bag of gold coins into the window. And the next day, the father discovered miraculously he now had the necessary money to pay the dowry for his first daughter. And this took place two more times. Nicholas again throws bags of gold a second time, so the second daughter to get married. And on the third occasion, the father decided that he would stay up at night to discover the identity of this benefactor. And he discovered it was, in fact, Nicholas. Nicholas admonished him not to reveal his identity, but he did. And thereafter, Nicholas became very famous as an alms giver, as one who is giving away his fortune to help those in need. So this is sort of the story of how Nicholas is associated with gift giving. In some accounts, he is not able to throw the bags of gold through the window because the shutters are closed. And so he has to come down through the chimney. So you can see the parallels between St. Nicholas, the early stories of St. Nicholas as a gift giver, and how he has to make his way through a chimney. The tradition of leaving gifts became popularized after the death of Nicholas, and especially during the Middle Ages, of a gold coin or other small gifts being placed beside an open window or in shoes that are left before a fireplace. And the idea of gift giving would begin to become very much part of the cult of St. Nicholas, putting small gifts in stockings, etc. And these traditions are still very much alive, especially in Europe. So according to a few sources, Nicholas as a bishop was invited to attend the first ecumenical council that was convened by Constantine the Great in 325 AD at the important city of Nicaea, or Nicaea in Greek. That's the present-day city of Iznik in Turkey, that's famous for its tiles. So Nicholas joined more than 300 bishops at this very important religious gathering, in which a debate ensued regarding the triune nature of God, called Trinitarianism, which holds that God has three co-eternal and co-substantial persons, namely the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So this was a very heated argument among the clerics who attended this first ecumenical council. Now, there were opposing views regarding the nature of the triune, and the most heretical was advanced by the Egyptian cleric by the name of Arius, who had quite a following. So Arianism held that although Christ was the Son of God, he was not equal to God the Father. He was a separate entity begotten as the Son of God, but had a distinct nature and was not co-eternal and co-substantial with the Father. Now, Arius was very eloquent when he defended his position about the nature of Christ. And Nicholas, we're told, became very enraged. And at a certain point, he struck Arius in the face. In some accounts, he slapped him across the face, but in other accounts, he actually belted him. So Nicholas apparently had quite a temper. Some historians question this, but there are a number of sources who claim this, in fact, did happen. And so shocked were the other bishops at the council that they dragged Nicholas before Constantine, and Constantine decided, you bishops decide how you want to punish Nicholas, not I. So Nicholas was thrown into prison where he had to beg forgiveness, but Nicholas would not. I mean, he held tight to his position regarding the triune nature of God. Eventually, Constantine did free him, and the heretical Arian position was rejected in favor of Trinitarianism. And out of the famous Council of Nicaea came the famous Nicene Creed, which is a important dogma or tenet of both the Western and Eastern Orthodox churches. This is an image of Nicholas, a fresco, now in the famous Church of San Nicolo in the port city of Bari, showing Nicholas striking Arius across the face. So there are a number of stories connected with the hagiography of Nicholas. So these saintly accounts of Nicholas that were popularized shortly after his death in the first half of the fourth century. In one account, when he was released from prison after the persecution of Diocletian, he returned to his bishopric in Myra and began the destruction of pagan shrines and elevating them to churches. The most famous pagan shrine that he destroyed was a temple dedicated to Artemis, not the famous Temple of Artemis at Ephesus on the coast, but the Temple of Artemis Eleutheria, which was also quite a famous shrine dedicated to the goddess of hunt. There's another famous story of how he saved the life of three centurions who were condemned to death. Supposedly, Constantine had sent these three soldiers to Andriaki near Myra in order to squash an uprising. And just before they were going to be dispatched by sword, Nicholas intervened and prevented them from being executed. And then shortly thereafter, they converted to Christianity. Here is a Byzantine icon showing Nicholas in his robes with crosses. This is sort of the traditional garb that Nicholas wears in Greek Orthodox iconography. So you can see him stopping the executioner from beheading these three centurions. There's also an account of how Nicholas went to Constantinople and asked Constantine to lower the taxes of the people of Myra, which Constantine agreed to and gave him an edict, which he would bring back to Myra. In one account, he actually threw the edict into the sea, and it was miraculously discovered by the officials back in Myra, and the taxes were reduced. There are a few stories preserved that says that he was able to obtain wheat for his citizenry during some severe famines, which were quite common in the first half of the fourth century in this part of the world. And the story is told how he cajoled, eventually convinced the captain of a cargo ship that was carrying grain en route to Alexandria to sell him some of the grain. Initially, the captain said, "Well, I can't. How can I reconcile my accounts when I get to port?" But eventually, he acquiesced, and grain was sold to the people of Myra. And so Nicholas prevented his people from starving to death. Now, Nicholas would eventually become a patron saint of many, especially of children. And there's the famous story of how he rescued three children who were about to be chopped up by a butcher and thrown into a tub of brine. This became a very celebrated story. He also became the patron saint of merchants and sailors, and especially with sailors, he was celebrated, especially in Greece and Russia, and quite a few churches were erected in honor of Saint Nicholas, the mariner saint. Here you see an image of Saint Nicholas with a small shrine of a church dedicated to him, and you see a boat with sailors, and many churches dedicated to him have votive offerings, ex votos, as they are called. So you provide this votive offering in front of his icon, and in return, you pledge that you'll perform some good deed in honor of Saint Nicholas, especially if your life was preserved at sea or during a plague. You can see here, you can just make out this silver ex voto, very thin sheet of silver in repose. It shows a ship. So even today, if you go to a church in Greece dedicated to Saint Nicholas, you'll see many of these votive offerings. So Nicholas very much celebrated as the patron saint of sailors as well as merchants. So tradition holds that Nicholas died on the 6th of December in 343 and was buried in Myra. Myra today is the Turkish town of Demre. And very shortly after his death, pilgrimages were made. In fact, one of the most important pilgrimage sites during the early Byzantine era, lending authenticity that he was in fact a historical figure. About 200 years after his death, the Byzantine Emperor Theodosius II ordered the construction of a church dedicated to him on the top of his remains. And later, a more magnificent church was constructed in around 520 during the reign of the Emperor Justinian. And the cult of Nicholas really exploded during this time, in which many faithful flocked to Myra in order to pay homage to Saint Nicholas. There is a miracle associated with his tomb, in which the gum resin myrrh that we discussed last week in connection with the gifts of the Magi. Myrrh was a very costly gum resin, highly prized, that was used to produce costly perfume or incense, used in embalming in Jewish rituals. And the story of the miracle of the myrrh, purportedly every year, this ointment of myrrh leaches from the tomb of the saint, and the ointment is collected. So there are accounts of this miracle already taking place as early as the 7th century. A number of suspect biographies began to appear around the cult of Nicholas, especially in the 800s. Many of them are not altogether reliable, but there are more, there are some historical sources that describe how the remains of Saint Nicholas were transported to the Italian port city of Bari. That's a port city located near the boot of Italy. And the story is told of how Muslim invaders were overwhelming Asia Minor, especially the Seljuk Turks were overwhelming huge tracts of Byzantine territory, especially after the Battle of Manzikert, in which the Byzantine army suffered a terrible defeat at the hands of the Turks. So during this turbulent period in which Asia Minor is being overwhelmed by Muslim forces, the story goes of how Italian sailors from the port city of Bari secretly removed the relics of Nicholas and brought them back to the city of Bari, where a magnificent basilica to Saint Nicholas was erected, and the remains of Nicholas were placed there. Now, this is a period in which a lot of relics of saints are transported to great Italian cities. Of course, the famous story of how the relics of Saint Mark were brought to Venice, and Mark becomes the great patron saint of the great port city of Venice. There are conflicting stories about these relics and where the remains of Nicholas were finally placed. In some accounts, he was brought to the island of Gemlae, which was an island off the coast of Myra. And some claim that's in fact where his remains were initially interred, not Myra, perhaps placed there because of fear that the invading Muslim marauders would steal the bones of Nicholas. They were transported to the island of Gemli, or Gemela, as it's called. And as I mentioned, especially after the famous Battle of Manzikert in 1071, the whole area was in a state of turmoil. So we find the remains of Nicholas being transported to the port city of Bari. But there's some accounts that some of the bone, not all the bones, were transported to Bari. Some of them were brought near Venice. So once again, Venice, specifically to the island of Lido in the Venetian lagoon. And there too, a beautiful church was erected beginning in the late 11th century, early 13th century, perhaps. A church was constructed, San Niccolo, and perhaps some of the bones were transported there as well. So Bari now becomes one of the great pilgrimage sites of Roman Catholicism. Nicholas still widely venerated in the East, but Bari becomes the most important Western Christian site for celebrating Saint Nicholas on his feast day in 2000, on the 6th of December. And again, once a year, reports of the miracle of the myrrh, in which miraculously appears oozing out of the crypt of Nicholas at his church in Bari. The ointment is collected in vials and then sent out throughout throughout many areas of the Western Church. Now, there have been scientific researches that have been conducted on the remains of Saint Nicholas in Bari, going all the way back to the 1950s. Vatican permitted the crypt to be open to analyze the bones, and a number of measurements were taken. In 2004, more scientific research was conducted, more advanced research conducted, and it was determined by Italian researchers that the skull, when it was examined, that the nose had been broken, the shoulder bone also had been fractured. And radiocarbon dating confirms that these bones, in fact, were not bones that were placed during the Middle Ages, which was often the case, sort of forgery and fake bones being interred. But in fact, these bones, radiocarbon dating, in fact, showed that they belonged to a male figure, some 5 feet 6 inches in height, dating to the 4th century. And in 2004 and 2014, there was an attempt to recreate what Nicholas, Bishop of Myra, may have looked like. And let's see, I think I have here, this is a famous fresco cycle. I mean, the Church of St. Nicholas in Bari is magnificently adorned. If you ever visit, it's just stunning iconography dedicated to the life of Nicholas, his many exploits. And this is, a possible visage reconstruction of Nicholas. So, you know, based upon ostensibly, you know, close analysis of the skull and how this individual in the Near East, you see that he has sort of the features that we associate with maybe Semitic people or darker skinned individuals who would have lived in Asia Minor during the 4th century. So also, as I mentioned, the discovery and then scientific analysis in 2014 showing, in fact, that this individual did have a broken nose, which had partially healed. Some have suggested that the broken nose occurred during his persecution during the reign of the Emperor Diocletian, the Great Persecution of 303. So in the subsequent centuries, Nicholas enjoyed wide popularity and veneration, not only in the West, but especially in the East, especially among the Orthodox countries of Greece and the land of the Rus in Russia. So now we get to the Middle Ages, and he was seen as this benefactor of the downtrodden and one who brought gifts to children and those who were good. And there were celebrations that began to take place in honor of Saint Nicholas, but these celebrations, especially during the Middle Ages, were conflated with pagan deities, especially the Roman god Saturn. And the feast day of Saturnalia, the feast day in honor of the sun god Sol Invictus, that had been celebrated even centuries earlier during Roman period, still was widely celebrated even during medieval times. So this was a pagan holiday, the feast day of Saturnalia, and that's why a competing Christian holiday was celebrated around this important Saturnalia, this raucous pagan holiday with all sorts of merriment and drunkenness, a competing Christian holiday celebrated in honor of Saturn. And in Nordic countries, Odin was celebrated. And Odin became connected by the process of syncretism with Saint Nicholas. So this happens often where Christian saints, whether it's the Virgin Mary or other famous saints of the early church, are often associated with pagan deities, and oftentimes the Christian celebration co-opts pagan rituals and pagan traditions. And this was the case with Saint Nicholas. So we find Nicholas associated with Odin, who's often depicted with a white beard and with mistletoe. And Odin in Norse mythology is often shown leading a hunting party through the great firmament, riding his eight-legged horse. And that image, of course, is translated and carried over into the story of Saint Nicholas or Santa Claus riding his sleigh with eight reindeer. So we have this Nicholas or white-bearded Odin figure with magical powers who has the ability to fly through the sky. And children knew that Nicholas would bring them gifts if they were good. Now, in medieval England, Nicholas was, his feast day on the 6th of December was also very much popularized and celebrated. During the Yuletide, we have the celebrations of the boy bishops, in which young lads were made for a short time priests and bishops. Also other traditions of nuns leaving foodstuffs and clothes or little bits of money anonymously outside the doors of the downtrodden. Also, especially among sailors, the feast day of St. Nicholas was celebrated, and they would go to market fairs in honor of St. Nicholas and buy gifts that they would bring back to their home and give to children. So, and that's something, the feast day of St. Nicholas, still very, very popular, especially in Greece. So there are many other legends that began to emerge, especially during the Middle Ages. There is one story of how Nicholas had been kidnapped, and we find him being brought to the Nordic countries, where he is celebrated as Sinterklaas. In some accounts, he has a sidekick, the Grampus, who is sort of this demonic figure. Other portrayals of him as more of a disheveled, sort of dirty gift giver, goes by the name of Ashy Claus or Ashken Claus or the sort of rough and tumbly Ruklaus. But very popular in the Nordic countries, especially in Holland. Now, during the Reformation, this great upheaval in Christendom, inaugurated by Martin Luther in 1517, the veneration of saints was widely was not looked upon favorably by Protestants, but that was not the case in Holland. Nicholas worshipped as Sinterklaas. Here you see some images of Nicholas, who looks like kind of like a white-bearded Odin, but in a clerical garb and holding mistletoe. Image on the right, he looks like a more sinister image of him. Again, as sort of this rough and tumbly Ruklaus, Nicholas. Now, eventually, Nicholas, St. Nicholas, as Sinterklaas, by way of Dutch colonists, makes his way to the New World, in particular in New Amsterdam, as New York City was once called in the 17th century. And among the Dutch colonists, he was venerated on his feast day of December 6th. And eventually, Sinterklaas became known as Santa Claus or Santa Claus. So among the many Nordic folktales, Saint Nicholas, Santa Claus, Sinterklaas is shown as this sort of magician who punishes children who have misbehaved, but the good children are presented with presents. In December of 1773, and again in 1774, a New York newspaper reported that a number of Dutch families gathered together to honor the death of Saint Nicholas. But he gains even more popularity in 1809 when Washington Irving of Ichabod Crane fame publishes his book, The Famous Knickerbocker History of New York. And this is the first time that Saint Nick is portrayed as a pipe smoking Nicholas soaring over the rooftops in a flying vehicle. So I should also mention, in New England in particular, especially during the Puritan period, this idea again of worshiping a saint was eschewed. And, the idea of celebrating Saint Nicholas or the Saturnalia was not looked upon favorably. But again, with a publication of Washington Irving's History of New York, and again in 1821, an anonymous poem, The Children's Friend, popularized our image of Saint Nicholas and our association of him as a giver of gifts during the Yuletide became very much disseminated in New England. The magical gift bringing of Saint Nicholas, however, now is stripped of his religious trappings. So a lot of the religiosity of Saint Nicholas now gives way to these more pagan, secular associations and trappings of Nicholas. So, his furry garb, sometimes it's red, sometimes it's green. The mistletoe, which we associate with Celtic rituals, this shaggy Germanic gift bringer. Further, the publication of Clement Moore's A Visit from St. Nicholas or The Night Before Christmas, Moore wrote this. He was an Episcopalian minister. He wrote this little account for his six children, not knowing that his description of St. Nicholas would become immensely popular. He had a best-selling, his book became a bestseller, and it's really the publication of this small poem really that really made St. Nicholas popular in the States. And thereafter, of course, Nicholas would be co-opted. Here's just a number of images from the late 19th century, different illustrations of St. Nicholas, the one on the right, showing his long green robe with fur and him wielding all these gifts. Here on the left, is the cover of Clement Moore's Visit of St. Nicholas. Here you see another cover by Clement C. Moore of Nicholas climbing down the chimney with a bag of gifts in his sack. There's another image of St. Nicholas. Again, you can see some more of the Nordic pagan accoutrements, mistletoe again. But again, you see the merging of sort of pagan and Christian, but eventually, you know, he loses all his sort of religious trappings. And then, of course, he becomes the image in many commercials and used by many famous products, especially Coca-Cola and Santa Claus, used in Montgomery Ward ads alongside his reindeer and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and Miracle on 34th Street. So Santa Claus now comes in full circle, you know, from St. Nicholas to this iconic commercial image that we are all very familiar with, the jolly St. Nicholas. So there you have it, our brief discussion of St. Nicholas, the historicity behind the story of St. Nicholas, his veneration, his popularity immediately after his death, somewhere around the mid-fourth century, and his continuing veneration during the Middle Ages, and how he's popularized, you know, especially in the 19th century America, and how he becomes this sort of commercial icon in the 20th century and in the 21st century. So that wraps up our three-part series on traditions associated with Hanukkah and Christmas. I want to wish all of you a very Merry Christmas, a safe Christmas. I know you'll be celebrating it at Spring Lake Village, sadly without your family, but hopefully next year things will get back to normal. So look forward to seeing you again next year, 2021, on Friday, the 8th of January. So take care, and I'll see you again very soon.